Well, thank you for opening PyData, and together with my colleagues, Geert, Ruud, Maurice, and Hal from Pipple, we have the honor to give the first tutorial of PyData this year. My name is Lars Kravlieg, and together with my colleagues from Pipple, Pipple is a small consultancy firm in Eindhoven, and we are, of course, always looking for smart people in the data science field. But we also do data science not only for big multinationals who basically just want to earn money, but also for a purpose goal. And that's why we say data science with purpose. It's in our slogan, and today's case will also show you something about how data science can help, in this case, a humanitarian aid organization to provide humanitarian aid. So every year, around 90,000 people are killed by humanitarian disasters, and 160 million are worldwide affected. They either lose their house or they get injured. For example, in early September 2017, Hurricane Irma struck the island of St. Maarten, and a large part of the area was affected. And to be able to assist very quickly for humanitarian aid organization, it's very important to have quick information about what the damage actually is on such an island. And in this case, one thing how we can do that is by looking at maps from satellite images or from drones to see from above which houses are affected and see if they are damaged. For example, from above you can see if a house is not damaged at all, if it can be repaired, or if it is completely destroyed. One way to do this is by using satellite images or drone images and basically coloring them by hand. So looking at the photos and see, okay, well, this house is damaged, it needs some repairs, so we need to send funds to that location. Well, to do that by hand, that will largely depend on the volunteers. But as you can imagine, that's time-consuming, labor-intense, and honestly, I would say it's also quite boring work to color thousands of maps to see what buildings are affected. So therefore, 510, initiative of the Red Cross, it's basically the data science group within the Red Cross, where Pipple is collaborating with, is investigating the possibilities to automate this process. And by automating, you already feel where it's going to classify satellite images from the images by using a machine learning model. In this way, if we can train a model that can provide automated classification of the damage after or even before a humanitarian disaster affects an area, the Red Cross will be able to assist way more accurately what the damage is and what help an area needs. This problem boils down to actually two sub-problems. One is on satellite images to detect where the buildings are located, and the other one is to see if we have detected a building, what kind of material the roof is made. Because roofs, they give a lot of information about the vulnerability of a building to a flood, a hurricane, or an earthquake. You can imagine that a roof made out of stone or concrete is way more robust against a flood than a roof that is made out of wood or corrugated sheets. So that's why in today's tutorial we'll focus on trying to classify roofs, whether they are made out of flat or corrugated, and that will reveal a lot of information for a humanitarian aid organization where they will need to send their funds to. So my colleague Maurice, he will explain in more detail the technical aspects of what we'll do today. So Maurice, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you. So in today's tutorial, you'll be classifying individual buildings of Sint Maarten, whether they have a flat roof shape or a hipped roof shape. And in the challenge, afterwards, you'll be classifying the roof type materials of these individual buildings. The workshop is structured as follows. I will talk to you step by step all of the things you need to know how you should develop your own deep learning model. This will last about 40 minutes. Then you have time to play around yourself in this tutorial, adjust things, see what the effects are on the performance of your deep learning models, ask questions, of course, and then after 1 hour, we'll start the challenge. We do a bit of explanation, and then you have time to submit your own models in Teams. So that's how it is structured. The first thing we start doing is opening this tutorial notebook. It's a notebook, so it has executable cell blocks and text cell blocks. And we'll be using it in a Google Colab environment. The way you can open it is as follows. You navigate in your web browser to Google Colab. And then you can select the tab GitHub. In there you type PIPLNL. And there you can find the challenge and the tutorial notebook. And for now we're opening the tutorial notebook. If you have troubles opening it, please raise your hand and we can help you. So if you type in PIPLNL for the GitHub URL, you should be able to see two notebooks, and you can open them by clicking on this tab. In this tutorial, you'll see text cells and executable commands. For these text cells, you don't need to read them right away. I will talk you through it, and afterwards you can use it as a reference and as a sort of assistance when you will be working on your own. The executable commands you can execute yourself, such that the whole code is working for you guys. Are there still people who have problems opening the tutorial notebook? Yeah, you must be locked. You must be logged in with your Google accounts. That's maybe causing issues. Okay, we'll start the tutorial then. The first thing you should think of when you start training your deep learning model is that you should activate a GPU if you have that available. And luckily, Google Colab has a GPU available. So the first thing we're actually going to do is we're going to select the GPU hardware. And you can do that by clicking on this runtime tab, opening it, and go to change runtime type and activate this GPU hardware. And click Save. And this is actually the image that should be the result of our tutorial today. So we have an aerial image of individual buildings of Sint Maarten. And We feed that to the deep learning algorithm we're going to develop. And in the end, it will classify whether roofs are shaped flat or hipped. And in the challenge, we also want to classify the materials of this roof. By running this cell block, you actually retrieve the data of these individual buildings. These are presented in a Git repo, and you clone this repo in by executing this cell block, and you will have a train and validation set. We're both located in the temp directory of the local file system of this Google server. And the structure of these images and these data sets are as follows. So always when you start training a deep learning model or start classifying things, you should think of a proper structure of the data set. And we did that for you in this workshop. And this is an image of how you can do that. So you have different sets, train, validation, and test sets, in which you have labeled classes. And in there you have the images. And that's also the structure that that's currently presented in this workshop. These are just some bash shell commands to get a bit more comfortable with the local file system of this Google server and where all files are located. You execute command cells by pressing Control Enter. And now let's talk about convolutional neural networks. This will be the method we'll be using to develop our deep learning model. For those who are not yet familiar with CNNs, the convolutional neural networks, we should think of this as a special type of neural network. Neural networks are very powerful classifiers, but in most cases you use neural networks when you have maybe hundreds of features or thousands of features. But for image classification, the number of features could easily exceed over a million. So there's so many features that the ordinary neural networks are just not very well well, able to do a proper classification. And for those cases, they invented different layers, the convolutional layers, and that's also where the convolutional neural network gets its name from. And in a sense, you can say that convolutional neural networks, they sort of extract useful information out of an image and they reduce the number of features. So this is this part of the convolutional neural network. So you have, in convolutional neural networks, you have two parts. You have a feature learning part and you have a classification part. In the feature learning part, you extract useful information out of an image, reduce the number of features, and then in the end, you just use ordinary neural network layers to do the classification. In a sense, you could also use different classification algorithms. You could also use a random forest or a support vector machine, for instance. But when we talk about convolutional neural networks, this is the structure. So first, a couple of layers that extract useful features. Those are most of the time convolutional layers. And then in the end, we have ordinary classification layers. And for a CNN to be able to perform well on a classification task, you need to train all of these parameters. And all of these layers, you have parameters that you need to optimize. And for optimizing all of these parameters, you ideally want to optimize all of these parameters based on your own target set. In this case, the individual buildings of St. Maarten. However, to be able to optimize all of these parameters, and especially if you have a lot of parameters, you might need millions of images. And in most cases, you don't have such a big data set. And for those situations, they thought of something else, and that's transfer learning and fine-tuning. And that's also the thing we're going to use in our tutorial. And what it basically means is that we're using the first part of our algorithm. We sort of download and retrieve these information, these layers, and these parameters already optimized from a different model, publicly made available, trained on millions of data points. So these are very well-trained layers, and we just retrieve it from a different model, a pre-trained model. And then we add our own classification layers on top of that, these layers. And that's transfer learning and fine-tuning. So we transfer the learning of a different model, and then we fine-tune those, those models, those layers, to be able to classify our own object of interest, which is in this case the shapes of roofs. So that's quite important to understand. So it's fine-tuning, it's transfer learning and fine-tuning in this tutorial. And if you want to have more information about that, you can visit this link. It explains it very well. And fine-tuning and transfer learning and fine-tuning is made very easy in Python by the Python libraries Keras and TensorFlow. So that's also the reason, part of the reason that we're using Keras and TensorFlow for this tutorial. And like I said, we're also going to fine-tune, so we transfer learning from a different model, but we're also going to fine-tune our own added classification layers, and therefore we need our data, of course. And Keras has these image data generators that can be used to feed your data to the training procedure of your algorithm. And the nice thing about these image data generators is that they do real-time augmentation. And augmentation sort of enlarges your data set. So if you look at this example, we for instance have one kitten for the image in our data set, but if we do augmentation, we slightly rotate it, we zoom in, zoom out, or maybe flip it, then we can create a lot more images out of this one image. And that's what augmentation does. And it's really powerful to do your training method. And Keras also has the ability to do that on the fly, real-time augmentation, how they call that. So you don't need to do augmentation at front and, load all of these images into memory. Keras does this on the fly, making it very efficient to do the training procedure. And that is actually what this code block does. So in here, we create image data generators for the train set, and we specify the augmentation parameters. And we also specify a preprocessor function, and that has to do with the transfer learning part. If we use a model of the internet that extracts useful information out of images, but they say, well, I only accept inputs between 0 and 1 figures, then of course our images also need to be processed to have values between 0 and 1. So that's the preprocessor function. And you typically only allow augmentation for the train set. For the validation and test set, you not always allow augmentation. And in here, we specify the image data generator for the validation set. If you scroll down a bit, then you see here another cell block. And these functions link the augmentation process to the local file system of this Google server in here with the flow from directory method. So we specify in here the train directory. So this is just a path to the local file system of this Google server, such that Keras is able to know how to do this real-time augmentation. We specify the batch size. We also specify a target size. This again has to do with the transfer learning part. If our feature extraction layers accept an image input of, let's say, 300 by 300, then of course our images also need to be reshaped to that input. So this function defines the generators such that Keras is able to do this real-time augmentation. And in here, we have a cell block that lets you see the results of a batch. So if you execute this command, you can see the actual images that will be fed to the algorithm. Hello. So in here we have 16 images in one batch, and we see, the aerial image, aerial view of individual buildings, and the label that it has. So this is a flat building, and in here we have a hipped building. After we created these data image generator objects, we can start thinking about the transfer learning part and the fine-tune part. That's actually the part where we built our own deep learning model. And for this tutorial, you can choose between three different transfer learning models. Which is the VGG16, the Inception V3, and the Exception model. And those are three publicly made available CNNs, and they perform very well on the ImageNet dataset. Those are, well, that is a database of millions of images, and they classify a lot of different things, such as cats and dogs and table and chairs. And the idea is that the feature extraction part of these layers, which for instance recognize different colors and patterns, are also useful for our own classification part. And that's why we use this transfer learning part. And on top of that transfer learning part, we add our own classification layers. And that's executed in this cell block. So and this is done with the Keras applications library. In here you can see that. So when using this library, we can actually say Well, I want to use, for instance, the VGG16 architecture. In here, I want to have the weights as well optimized on the ImageNet dataset, but I'm not interested in this top classification layers because I want to add my own classification layers for my own problem. And then I specify all of these base model layers, these feature extraction layers. You don't need any more. You don't need to train them anymore. But we're adding extra layers, extra classification layers. These are just ordinary neural network layers. And there, we first flatten all of the base model output. And that's just reshaping all of the figures which are extracted out of the images into one big array of numbers. And then we specify, well, I want to add an ordinary dense layer, an ordinary fully connected layer of 256 nodes, another one, and we end with a dense layer of two nodes. And we end with two nodes because our classification problem has two classes, either flat or hipped. And that's why we end our classification layer with two nodes. So this part of the tutorial builds our CNN model, and these top part layers that we've added, they're just randomly initialized. The parameters of these layers are randomly initialized, so these need to be trained. The difference, you mean, or?
No, I mean just because it is a dense, why do you say it's convolutional on the comments? Maybe I'm missing the...
Well, this is just how chaos defines these layers.
Okay.
If you want to use a convolutional layer, then you type in a different command.
But you're defining a dense, but then on the comment it's...
Oh, yeah, okay. But yeah, it's a classification layer in a convolutional neural network.
Okay.
That's why we...
Yes, that's
okay. So when you build the model, you can start training, of course. And chaos trains a CNN by the use of the fit generator method in here. But before you can execute this fit generator method, you should compile your model. And by compiling your model, you tell chaos how it should train all of these parameters, what kind of loss function should be training it, what kind of optimizer you should be using, and also an evaluation metric that you want to return for the user. Next to that, you should also think of the so-called Keras callbacks. And these are sort of methods or definitions that log your training results. If you want to compare different models, usually you want to do that. You want to train different models and see the difference between those models, which model is converging faster, which model has a better accuracy. You want to log all of these information so that you can do this comparison. And Keras deals with that by the so-called chaos callbacks. So these are two things you need to think of before training your model in Keras. One of which is compiling your model, and the other one is defining your chaos callbacks. Compiling is done in this cell block. So in here we actually call the previously defined function. So in here we download a pre-trained neural network, and we add our own classification layers on top of that. And then we say, well, compile it and use this loss function to optimize with the stochastic gradient descent optimizer. And you should return the model's accuracy on screen. This cell block defines the Keras callbacks. And to make it a bit more understandable, you should think of Keras callbacks in sort of two ways. One of which is you actually log information in a single file, could be a CSV file, in which you say, well, after every iteration of training, log the model's accuracy on the train set and the validation set. Also log the loss objective function value. And for instance, also this is the disease field logger, and also the model checkpoint callback, which is logging the model's parameters in just a single file, and .hdf5 file, to be more specific. The other way of thinking about chaos callbacks is a tensor board event folder, and this is also the callback we'll be using in this tutorial. And this is a special type of callback because it is displaying all of your logging parameters in a dashboard, an interactive dashboard called the tensor board. It's software developed by TensorFlow itself, so it's very well integratable with your deep learning training results. By default, you have that this tensor board event folder logs your validation accuracy and objective value of the loss function, and also for the train set and validation set. But if you want to add more statistics that you want to compare for different models, you can do that as well with this these lines of code. So in here we actually add the learning rate of the optimizer during the training. You can add anything you want, but this is the way to do that. So in here, in this part of the code, we actually define all of these chaos callbacks: the CSV logger, model checkpoint, the tensor board callback. And another thing we did in here is that we added a timestamp, because of course, if you want to compare different training results, you need to have unique file names, otherwise they keep on overwritten. And then finally we can start training. And this is done in this cell block. And in here we actually call all of the previously defined functions, and we start training the model with the FET generator method. So first we define the model, one of the three, to do this transfer learning part. Then we compile and build our own CNN model. Then we also generate these so-called image data generator objects. And all of these are fed into this fit generator method. And this part of the function is commented. These calculate class weights. This could also be an extra parameter for your fit generator method if you want to pay more attention to a sample from underrepresented classes. It could be nice to see the differences. And when you execute this cell block, you see that your model starts training. In this case, we trained for 5 iterations, so 5 epochs, and in each epoch we used, in this case, 30 batches of images. If you want to increase the number of iterations, you should increase the number of epochs in here. If you want to increase the number of batches used per training round, then you should increase the steps per epoch. And this is the part where we can start evaluating the training results of our models. Every time you train a new model, it pops up in here. And you can toggle them if you want to see the results. You can, and all of these metrics that you log during your chaos callbacks can be visualized in here. And it's an interactive dashboard. It's a very nice tooling. You should get familiar with this. You can even see the total structure of the graph and the model you built. So it's quite a large model, you can see. And most of it is the pre-trained neural net, the pre-trained convolutional neural network that you downloaded from the internet and reused. So only these top layers are the layers we've added. And all of these other layers, they are from the pre-trained model. And this is a really nice tooling developed by TensorFlow. It really helps in choosing the best model for your problem. And that's actually all I wanted to say for this tutorial right now. So you have time to play around yourself in this tutorial notebook, start reading, start asking questions, start changing different parameters and see how the results are changing in this TensorBoard dashboard. And of course, have fun. You can reuse almost any kind of function that we define in this tutorial. But you will be building your own deep learning model on a different kind of classification problem. And to open this tutorial notebook, the challenge notebook, you can do actually the same thing. So you browse towards the Google Colab website, you enter PIPLNL for the URL, and then you open this PyData challenge materials notebook. And we again have a challenge a notebook, but in here we haven't specified all of the parameters, so you can choose your own parameters and develop everything yourself. Tomorrow at noon, the challenge is due. So then we'll measure the performance of all of your submitted models. We have an independent test set, which you cannot see, but we can. So if you submit your model, we'll be able to use that model and measure the accuracy on this independent test set. And that's how we will measure the performance of all of the submitted models. I think it's best to work in teams. In here, in this notebook, when you eventually have trained your models, you can submit it by the last cell block. And in here, you can specify your team name and the model that you want to submit. And this will automatically be uploaded to an S3 bucket that we'll be using for this evaluation. So think of a nice team name, and also email the names of the individuals that are in the team to PIPL, and I will present to you the email as well to which you should send this email. And then tomorrow morning at noon, the challenge is due, and tomorrow evening around 5 we'll announce the winner of the challenge in public, and it will receive a wonderful PIPL prize. So enjoy.